about ready to begin, so without further ado, I'll pass it over to Don Rose, Transit Board Chair.
Good morning. Thank you, Senator. Thank you all for being here this morning. We have a very important announcement to make. Unfortunately, we won't be surprising any of you with it, but we do have an important announcement that after a very comprehensive search, we're appointing a new CEO today. Before we get into that, I'd like to thank and acknowledge the people who are here with me. Mayor Goldberg, Linda Hepburn, who are both on the TransLink board of directors, and are also the chair and vice chair, respectively, of the TransLink Mayor's Council. Also, many of our directors, in addition to Gregor and Linda, are here in the audience. And importantly, I would like to acknowledge Kathy McClay. Kathy is the TransLink CFO, and over the past several months has stepped in and acted as CEO while we're waiting for the announcement of the new CEO. Kathy, you've done a very excellent job. And on behalf of the board, I'd like to thank you very much. Now, the main reason we're here this morning is to announce that after a comprehensive international search, the TransLink board has chosen Kevin Desmond as the new CEO. Kevin is currently the general manager of King County Metro Transit. Kevin is uniquely position to take on the role of the TransLink CEO, coming from Metro, who has several parallels with TransLink. They serve a large geographic area. They have many modes of transit. They have gone through at least four funding referenda during Kevin's tenure, and they successfully implemented their electronic fare card system called ORCA under his leadership. The board was very impressed by Kevin. He shows excellent leadership, and one of his great skills is in building relationships. Relationships with customers, relationships with employees, and relationships with all the other stakeholders. Now, before we ask Kevin to say a few words, I'd like to turn the mic over to Mayor Robertson to say a few words on behalf of the Mayor's Council.
Thank you very much, Don, and good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us here at Waterfront Station. And on behalf of the Mayor's Council, of Vice Chair Mayor Hepner and I, we are thrilled to be welcoming Kevin Desmond as the new CEO of TransLink after this extensive search. It's also great to find someone else who's from close by. Our neighbors in Seattle, who's run a great transit system there, and who I know will bring the energy and the leadership that we need to really reinfuse TransLink with a new purpose and the opportunity to grow transit across our region. We've been working hard. Mayor Hepner and I were in Ottawa last week, meeting with the Prime Minister and ministers. We have Minister Sohi, the Infrastructure Minister, coming tomorrow here to Vancouver. Looking forward to seeing major investment from the federal and provincial government into the region to grow our transit system and improve transportation across the region, reduce traffic. That's the goal for our 10-year plan that the mayor has put together. And it's fantastic to have a new leader who can bring everything together, the combination of funding, a focus on customer service. I think kudos to Kathy McLay, our interim CEO, for really pulling things together in the TransLink team, focusing on customer service over the past many months, and I think doing a great job of preparing the ground for Mr. Desmond here, who we have tons of confidence in and look forward to working with, along with the board, the Mayor's Council, in a very collaborative new relationship, looking forward to supporting our new CEO, our CFO, and the whole team at TransLink to make sure that people to get around our region much more easily, much more safely, and that we attract that new investment this year to get our transit system improved and reduce the traffic. So I'll leave it there, and back to you, Don.
Thanks very much, Gregor, and Kevin, over to you.
Thank you, Don. Thank you, Mayor. And good morning, everyone. I started my morning this morning at the TransLink offices and got to meet much of the TransLink staff for at least a brief period of time and had some nice conversations with them. I'm very, very excited that this day has come. I'll be starting at TransLink on March 21st, which is really right around the corner, but visiting with Press Day, with TransLink folks is really the beginning as I start my journey to get to know this organization. Vancouver and the lower mainland area is an area that we in the Seattle region very much look up to and admire in many different ways. Best practices in land use policy and livability and certainly in transportation policy, and that's very much in, what's attracted me to consider this position and take this very, very important job, and I'm humbled by the board's confidence in bringing me on, and I know that there's a great task to be done. But I want to emphasize where we come from. I've been coming up off and on to Vancouver and this region for a number of years just to check out when I was at Pierce Transit and King County Metro, what's going on up here? What can we learn about transportation policy and land use policy and the development of a transit system? We're a little bit behind in the Seattle region. We're still building out even our first light rail line. We're having an extension open in just a few weeks to the University of Washington. So we want to catch up in our region to what Vancouver has in this region has provided. We do have a lot in common in many different aspects, and that's why I think I can hit the ground running well. Don mentioned a few of those things, the automated fare collection system, our ORCA system, the Compass program here. Ridership's a big deal to me. That's something I learned very much when I started my career at New York City Transit many years ago, almost 25 years ago, during my almost 12 years in Metro. All the different projects that we operated, we saw 24% increase in ridership over that period of time. I'm very passionate about ridership. If we're focused on ridership, that means we're focused on the customer. If we're focused on the customer as an organization, we're probably always focused on the right things. And that's the kind of ethic and set of principles I want to bring to this job as the CEO of TransLink. As I get started, most importantly, I need to listen. I need to listen to the people, the employees of TransLink, our customers, our various different partners in the jurisdictions and municipalities, the business community. What can we leverage that works really well at TransLink? I believe and I know a lot works really well at TransLink. Where do we need to pick it up and improve the services that we provide, improve the efficiency and effectiveness of the different products that TransLink is responsible for? So it's a learning process getting started. I spent a lot of time with Don and the other board members over the past number of weeks. I understand that TransLink has suffered a bruise to its brand. In the last couple of years here have been challenging. Losing a plebiscite, losing a referendum is never an easy task. I've been part of four referenda in my tenure down in the Central Puget Sound region, three of which were successful, one of which was not. It's tough to lose. It feels a lot better to win. So restoring public trust and confidence in the transit system, I understand that to be job number one, and I'm delighted to be working with what I believe is a fine organization to pull that brand up. So with that, I think we can take some questions.
Yeah, so we'll just be taking questions one at a time, please. So first question.
I was born in Waco, Texas, actually, but I grew up in New York.
So, TransLink's strange mix of mobile things. We've got buses, we've got trains, we've got over. We've also got bridges and roads and stuff like that. This is a bit of a different animal, because if you've got a sort of bizarre governance structure,
you know, as Don said and I mentioned, there's a lot of similarities. Our region, for my entire tenure actually my 19 and a half years in Central Puget Sound region and the last almost 12 in Metro, has been dominated about the discussion of transit and roads. Road maintenance, roadway expansion versus transit maintenance, transit expansion. Whether it's the state of Washington, it's the major funder, road projects and based on our highway system, the local jurisdiction, King County has a responsibility for that. In fact, the department that I'm part of is King County Department of Transportation that has roads and bridges responsibilities for unincorporated King County. And we're facing a very, in fact, severe challenge with funding for those roads. The funding's dried up. We have a very significant problem with state of good repair. So state of good repair and or expansion of the capacity of the roadway network is a dominant discussion in our region, and I've been part of that discussion. And you need to find a balance. I believe that an organization like TransLink, and I talk about this all the time for my organization, we're about managing the capacity of the transportation network. And TransLink's role is to help manage the capacity and get the most out of the capacity. You can only expand roadway right-of-way so much in a heavily built environment. We face that in our region, hemmed in by mountains and water. You face that here. So our job is, how do you get the most out of that network? And we can do that with transit. It's nothing wrong with roads and bridges. People have to get around. We want to provide the choices. As a transit agency, people have choices, and we maximize the capacity in the most efficient manner of the network. That's the ticket to a very effective and hopefully growing economic and land use environment here. And good quality of life.
Next question right here, please. Yeah.
Well, you know, I don't have a prescription. I don't have an action plan today. As I said in my remarks, the first thing I need to do is listen. The first thing I need to do is get out in the system, get out amongst our employees. The employees know a lot about the system, and I need to hear from them. The people at the ground level, the people that answer the telephones, the people that clean the stations and the bus stops, the people that drive the trains and buses and the water taxi. I need to listen to them. I need to hear about from the customers. That's who's paying the bill. I need to find out how we can improve the reliability and the convenience of the system. If we're improving reliability and convenience, ultimately that's how you attract and retain customers. And if we've got a good level of customer satisfaction, I think the rest of it flows. Clearly, we need to work with stakeholders. That's at least my understanding in my dialogue with the board over the last number of months. The many stakeholders throughout the Lower Mainland, all the different cities, the jurisdictions, the mayor's council. Previous question mentioned governance. We have a very complicated governance structure where I'm from as well. So actually, there are more similarities in the governance structure here than there actually than you may think between the Seattle region and TransLink. So I need to hear from all of those people first before I have a game plan. I truly believe there's a lot of innovative and creative juices in an organization like TransLink. I believe my job is to let those innovations and creative thoughts bubble up, and how can we catalyze really good ideas and bring those out. And be honest and transparent when we're not doing a good job. I mean, we just, honesty is the best approach. Let's have a dialogue.
Okay, next question right
there. Mr. Desmond, I understand King County Metro was under King County government. TransLink was run by a board of directors and mayor council, and they were fighting for who had more power on the board between the provincial government, which is the state government and the cities. Do you think your job will be easier here, listen to the board, or will be easier down there, listen to elected officials on the voters?
I wouldn't use the job the word easy in any context. The governance structure in King County is fairly complicated. At any given time, I have three bosses. We have a permanent full-time government in King County. The King County Executive is a permanent, very activist, very progressive office. He's elected every 4 years, and one of the most prominent elected positions in the entire state of Washington, as a matter of fact. My governing board, if you will, is King County Council, 9 members who have been elected directly by the people of King County. We also have an entity called the Regional Transit Committee, which is all elected officials, but they're appointed to the Regional Transit Committee that is largely dominated by suburban interests, whereas King County Council is generally dominated by Seattle interests. So it's an interesting mix. The Regional Transit Committee is somewhat similar to the Mayor's Council, where the TransLink Board might be more similar to the King County Council. So I would say neither is easy. Both are complicated, and both are managing relationships. You have to keep a dialogue going, and you have to find a way to achieve a common ground with those interests. And that's been something that has dominated my entire 11 and a half years at King County Metro, is trying to manage often divergent points of view, but ultimately we have a mutual set of interests, and that's making our regional transit system as effective as possible, and is finding those areas of mutuality, and that's where you get the common discussion.
Next question, Ian.
Mr. Brandon, you said the TransLink is a really super brand. Two questions. Why do you want to be involved here? Why do you want to be involved here? Also, you say you have no game plan, then why do you hire?
Well, I like challenges, and clearly TransLink presents a new challenge. I've been at Metro for nearly 12 years. That's a very long time to run any large transit system anywhere in North America. Looking for a new challenge is, you always want a new challenge. I like to climb mountains. I like to ride bikes up mountain passes. I like to ski up mountain passes. So it's just another summit, it's just another climb, and I like the energy around the challenge, and I like to motivate people to try to achieve objectives and maybe stretch goals. When I say I don't have a game plan, I don't have a written out game plan. I've decided what we're going to do. I wouldn't come into any organization saying, I've decided what to do. I already know all the answers. I don't know all the answers, and I haven't decided what to do. I need to work with my board. I need to work with the Mayor's Council. I need to work with the province. I need to work with our employees to get a best sense of what's the best direction, directions, multiple, to move with TransLink. I have a very good sense in my gut of how to manage a place like TransLink. I have a very good sense of the public policy requirements of a public transportation organization as complicated as TransLink, and I think I can bring a lot of that to bear working closely with my board.
Next question over here.
I know you just got here. You don't start until March 21st, but you say you want to hit the ground running. You can want to know. You've obviously looked at transit. Let's see what transit, public transit. You've seen the trend. You've seen the problems. What's the number one thing right now you think you need to fix in that?
Oh, I couldn't tell you that. I need to get here and find that out. There's a multiplicity of issues. I think the issue with the public confidence side of the coin and the trust coming off of the failed election and some of the other issues, whether real or perceived in the public media, I have to be attentive to that. So clearly I have to be attentive to the rollout of Compass. Clearly I have to be attentive to the state of good repair of SkyTrain. Clearly I have to be attentive to customer satisfaction. These are all things that I would be looking at very closely.
The mayor beside you right now is sort of throwing you in, Mr. Robinson, but he is a big proponent on 24-hour SkyTrain service, later SkyTrain service. Is that something that you would like to see happen?
I would take that, and I didn't know that. That is something I would take into consideration with the board and with our partners. Do the finances allow for that? Is the demand there? What are the other needs for those funds that could be perhaps better used? I don't know the answers to those questions. I have to dig into this.
Okay, next question.
Two, I read through the mayor's council plan. It was put out before the plebiscite. And clearly, whatever the number is, the region needs to invest in the transit system. The region needs to invest in its transportation network. What the path forward is, I don't know. My sense is if the region is going to grow by over a million new residents over the next couple of decades, the transportation network is going to have to absorb and have the capacity to deal with those new residents and the employment that comes with that. So we're going to have to come up with the right kind of financing and funding strategy to make the transportation network effective to support the economic growth of this region.
Next question.
Mr. Desmond, from your experience, you talked about flagging in the economy. Talking this morning to some stakeholders in the transit industry, they said that there's never been a lower sense of confidence between riders and transit operators. So I'm curious, I know you don't have a plan or any specifics, but from your experience, how do you go into a system and say, I'm going to encourage ridership? There's some good ideas in that front.
Well, it happens in a number of different dimensions. I have a kind of point of view called total transit product. The intersection between the intending customer or the real customer and the transit system, there are a number of different places that happens. So the point at which you get to the bus stop, that might be your first interaction with the transit system. And what are you presented with? Are you presented with a bench with a shelter with good information about the service? And is the service arriving on time? Is the service frequent enough to make you an ongoing customer? Does the RAP network meet the changing land use and demands of the system? Do you change the network? Do you just add capacity to the system? How do you manage the interface with the customers with the heavy rail system? The same. All the different features and elements encompass your experience with the transit system. So there's not one answer. It's essentially all in. So you want to focus on all of those things. How do you get information? Are you comfortable waiting for the bus stop? Do you feel safe and secure in the context of the system? All of those feelings, those senses, your perceptions of the system, you're going to continue to use public transportation. So you need to be looking at all of those features. I will study the customer satisfaction information. We do every single year. Metro has been doing statistically valid customer satisfaction studies for 20 or 30 years. We know what turns our customers on and what turns our customers off in each of those attributes. What are the most important to them and where do we need to do better? You focus on those things, make investments, just better attention, and shift some of the resources around. People will notice those things and people will continue to be transit customers.
Next
so
question.
It's many different features.
Next question.
Kevin, I'm just wondering, I mean, you talk about the bruising image of TransLink. A lot of that relates to the Compass rollout. I'm wondering what you've learned through the rollout of the ORCA program in the Metro Seattle area that you think will apply here in Vancouver to bettering the Compass card system.
Well, actually, I've been part of a couple of major automated fare collection rollouts. The first was in New York, the MetroCard system, which is the old-fashioned magnetic stripe. And that was a challenge going forward. And we learned lessons from that and how you roll out an AFC system. The ORCA system, look, we didn't get it done very quickly either. I don't know of any AFC system anywhere in the world that can be implemented particularly quickly. They're very complicated. Ours was for 7 agencies. So we had to merge fare policy and had back office financial settlement for 7 different agencies. You need to make sure that when you roll it out, that all the systems are functioning. And you need to roll it out all at once. Part of the problem, I think, with AFC systems is if you roll it out piecemeal, people say, well, it works here, but it doesn't work there. It worked on SkyTrain, but it's still not on the bus. So it's not, I won't use it until I can make my Lyft trip, for example. You need to make sure that your ability to get a card, load value on a card, and get customer information, customer assistance, if something, get a question, something goes wrong, that you have available customer assistance and very good information. Websites for this electronic commerce, they can be complicated. You need to make sure that it is a very customer-sensitive, customer-friendly kind of website. You put all those things together and you're gonna have a popular product. In our customer satisfaction surveys, the number one favorable attribute of my entire system is the Orca program. Now, 6 years after we rolled it out, people use it, people love it, and it has helped to drive a lot of ridership, back to the ridership question, because people can make link trips with no transfer penalty between all of our regional systems.
Next question.
Yes, Mr. Desmond, in Seattle with Metro, successful free websites or all referendums to increase funding for that. We know we have to have some sort of increase in funding. We do have a website. One of the ones brought in, it had a $60 card tab, it had an increase in sales tax. Would we be looking at that here?
Oh, I wouldn't even touch that until we go through my discussions. That's something for dialogue. What the right financing sources are, there are a number of different options. We need to find, working with the board eventually, if it happens, what the best financing is available. But that's very premature for me to be able to comment on that.
What about the
I'm no longer having transit free service yet. We abolished that in 2012 as we were fighting to stay afloat after the Great Recession. I didn't say that. I just said that we had it for 30 years in Seattle, and we don't have it anymore.
Okay, and last question,
Kelly?
Okay, Michael?
You mentioned the importance of rolling out on that favorite credit card systems all at once. That's not what TransLink's done. They've got a staged process. So what are your criticisms for what they've put so far with the credit card system? Why is rolling it out at the same time better?
I do not have any retrospective criticisms of how TransLink rolled out the Compass system. So it is what it is. I'm coming in a few weeks, and I will be helping to manage the continued rollout of the Compass card.
Okay. Thank you, everybody, for coming.